Welcome to Canvas Online. My name's Robbie. If it's your first time joining us today, we are so glad that you are here. At Canvas, we exist to love God, love people, and serve others. And you can find out more about us by following us on social media or going to our website, canvasfl.com. If you've only attended Canvas Online, we would love to meet you in person. We invite you to join us on Sunday mornings at one of our services. Just go to our social media accounts or our website for updated times and information. Are you looking for more ways to connect with your Canvas family? Then Canvas groups are for you. We have both in-person and online groups, and we believe that there is a group designed just for you. Just go to canvasfl.com/groups to see all of them. Here at Canvas, we believe you cannot outgive God. Your giving actually makes it possible for us to continue to provide online services just like this one. So thank you, Canvas, for the way that you do give each and every week. And as always, there's no obligation to give. But if you do decide to give financially, you can do so online using canvasgive.com. We hope you enjoy the rest of our online service today.
Of the stories that have proved your faithfulness, I've seen miracles my mind can't comprehend. There is beauty in what I can't understand. Jesus, it's you. Jesus, it's you. Oh, I believe the wonder-working God, the wonder-working God. For the miracles I've seen, too good to not believe. The wonder-working God, you heal because you love. For the miracles we see, you're too good to not believe. Too good. I can resurrect a man with my own hands, but just the mention of your name can raise the dead. Oh, the glory to the only one who can. Jesus is here.
Too good to not believe. It's the wonder-working God. Well, welcome to Canvas Church. We're so glad that you are here today. If you are with us for the first time, we do find it amazing that every Sunday is somebody's first Sunday. And if that's you, we love you so much and glad that you came. You came in on a great day, as Pastor Robbie said. Today is Baptism Sunday, but it's also a part of a series that we have been doing for the last 2 weeks, last week and this week. And the reason that we're doing this series, we're calling it obviously Sacraments, is because we never want to fall into the trap of just doing religious activity for the sake of doing religious activity without our hearts and our minds being engaged with the understanding of why we're doing what we're doing. And I fear that it happens too much in the church and in the church world, and that's why we're doing a deeper dive into the two important sacraments that the scriptures have instructed us to observe as followers of Christ, communion and baptism. And just by sake of definition, a sacrament is just a Christian rite ordained by Christ that holds deep and meaningful spiritual significance. And last week, we did a deep dive into the significance and the power of communion. And if you were not here for that, I really want to encourage you to go back and listen to that on our app or our website. There is a chance that you have never heard communion just quite like that. We did a really significant dive into the purpose and why it's so pregnant with meaning and why it is so significant. It may change the way you take communion for the rest of your life. Big statement, but I believe it so much. And today, I want us to talk about the power of baptism while we are observing baptism. Now, here's what I know, and you know it as well. How you end up can often have a lot to do with how you begin something. How you end up has a lot to do with how you begin. It's true in a race. It's true in a business. It's certainly true in the Christian life and in our walk with God. There is a story in Acts chapter 8 about a follower of Christ by the name of Philip. He is a preacher of the gospel who introduces himself to an Ethiopian official who had somehow been to Jerusalem, been to this festival, got his hands on a copy of the Old Testament book of Isaiah, and the Bible says that he is reading it, but he doesn't understand it because he has no understanding of the history of the Israeli people or of the prophecies concerning Christ. But the Bible says that the Holy Spirit compelled Philip to go close to the man's chariot, and he hears this guy reading from the book of Isaiah. The Holy Spirit said, go to him and talk to him. And Philip goes to where he is, and he says, do you understand what you're reading? And he said, how can I? I know it has significance. I can tell there is something deep and meaningful about it, but I don't understand it unless somebody was to tell me. The Bible says Philip crawls up in the chariot with him, and he begins to tell him the good news, that the prophecies that he is reading that are ancient and hundreds of years old have just come to pass in the person of Jesus, that it's been fulfilled. Jesus has came. He died for our sins. He was raised to life again in a resurrection. And Philip shares that the way that we identify with this amazing experience is by accepting the sacrifice of Christ into our life, receiving his forgiveness, and then being baptized as an act of obedience in honor of God's work in our life. And I love what happens next. Bible says they are riding their chariot by a river, and the Holy Spirit's working in this guy's life. And the Ethiopian just looks over at Philip and he says, well, I mean, here's a river right here. Why can't I be baptized right now? And Philip says, you can. And they stop and they get out and he baptizes this man. It's just this amazing story in Acts 8 that I think illustrates how the Holy Spirit can work in a person's life, give them this deep desire to honor God and what it means to start their relationship right with God. Now, let me just do this because I really want to increase and help you understand. So today, I'm going to do a few things, but I want to start by addressing two great myths that I hear sometimes about baptism that I want to clarify for you. Here's the first one. First myth is you're not truly saved or redeemed until you are baptized. I've actually heard this taught before. I've heard people that really believe this and identified with this. This is false. The criteria of salvation is found in Romans chapter 10 and verse 9. Here's what it says. If you confess with your mouth that Jesus is Lord and you believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, you will be saved. This is what the thief on the cross did. He was taking his last dying breath, and in this moment of revelation, he was able to identify that who was hanging next to him was Christ, the Son of the living God. He identified his lordship and received him in his life. And when he prayed that prayer, Jesus said to him, "Today will you be with me in paradise." Here's the second myth that goes along with this one. Well, if baptism isn't essential for salvation, then it can't really be that important. Absolutely false. Absolutely false. It is vitally important. While baptism may not be necessary for salvation, it is necessary for obedience to Christ, which is an authentic sign of our salvation in Christ. God's word constantly emphasizes baptism as a response to God's work in our life through Christ and in order to walk in obedience to him. In fact, I will show you just how important baptism was to Jesus himself. In Matthew chapter 3, he begins at the age of 30 his earthly ministry by being baptized. He begins it like this in Matthew chapter 3. Then Jesus went from Galilee to the Jordan River to be baptized by John. He did it specifically. He did it on purpose, with a purpose, for a purpose. But John tried to talk him out of it. And he did this because he didn't feel worthy. He was his cousin, but he knew he was the Lamb of God to take away the sins of the world. And he said, "Dude, I need to be baptized by you. You don't need to be baptized by me." But Jesus said, "No, I'm the one who needs to be baptized by you. So why are you coming to me?" Jesus said, "It should be done, for we must carry out all that God requires." This is a whole nother thing, but man, the obedience that Jesus even had to his heavenly Father. So John agreed to baptize him, and after his baptism, something supernatural. As Jesus came up out of the water, the heavens were opened, and he saw the Spirit of God descending like a dove, settling on him. And a voice from heaven, can you imagine this? And a voice from heaven said, "This is my dearly loved Son, that brings me great joy." This is how he began his earthly ministry. Well, guess how Jesus ended 3 years later his earthly ministry? He has been crucified, buried. He has been resurrected from the dead on the third day. He's about to be taken back into heaven after he has shown himself to over 500 people. Over 500 people saw the resurrected Christ, and many of them testified of it, gave witness to it, and were martyred because of it. They would not relinquish their testimony of Christ because they could not deny what they had seen and heard in the resurrected Christ. It's so powerful. But just before he goes back to heaven on a cloud, here's what he says in Matthew 28. Jesus came and told his disciples, "I have been given all authority in heaven and on earth. Therefore, go and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit." It was so important to Jesus that he bookended his earthly ministry here on earth with baptism. He began his ministry with baptism, and he ended his earthly ministry physically with baptism. Now, in a moment, I want to share with you what really makes it so powerful and why it matters so much. But let me just show you where the word comes from and how it was used, because it has great significance to the methodology that we follow. Why we do it the way we do it. Why we have a tank full of water and we fully submerge people in it. The Greek word for the word baptism that we use in its original was baptizo, baptizo. Now, it was a very common word in biblical times. Not so much common to us. We pretty much use it only for one specific thing now, but not back then. They used it for a plethora of things. The word means to wash, to plunge, or to submerge. And people back then would use the word in everyday language to describe baptizoing their clothes. They would baptizo their dishes. They would baptizo themselves when they took a bath. In fact, just for a side note, kind of interesting, there was this guy named McCandor who apparently had this amazing recipe for making pickles in 200 BC. And he published his instructions for making these delicious pickles. And in his instructions, he wrote, "You take a cucumber and baptizo it in vinegar." Okay? In vinegar. You dip it or submerge it. Okay, this is why we don't sprinkle. This is why we don't splash, right? Because the methodology is in direct proportion to the word itself, and what the implication is that when we come to Christ, we do not come half-hearted. We do not come halfway. We do not make him half of the Lord over our life. We do not make him the Lord over some areas of our life. We don't make him the Lord over certain compartments of our life where we can still remain in control of others. When we come to the Lord and we say, "You are the Lord of our life," and we demonstrate it through baptism, we submerge. We are all in. We are all in. There's not a part of us that is not under the lordship of Jesus Christ. We are fully submerged. So everyone was familiar with the concept of baptizo. And when Jesus comes along and is baptized by his cousin, and it became primarily associated with how we connect and identify with Christ and what he does in our life right now. So today, let me just share with you quickly before we engage in this wonderful, wonderful, beautiful sacrament. The two things that I want us to talk about are the meaning and the motive. The meaning of baptism. What does it actually mean? What does it symbolize? And then the motive. Why did God instruct us to do it? Why was it one of the two things that were so important to Christ that we would observe it forever? So here we go. Number one, the meaning of baptism. Baptism is a physical and literal expression of our spiritual experience with Christ. It is a visible picture outwardly of what Jesus has done in our life inwardly. And Paul does a beautiful job in multiple places, but in the letter that he wrote to the Romans, he does this exceptional job of telling us what it really means. And I like the way the Message Bible really says it, so I'm going to just read it to you out of the Message in Romans 6. Paul said, so what do we do? Do we keep on sinning so that God can keep on forgiving? No, of course not. This isn't the way. If we've left the country where sin ruled our lives, then how can we still live in our old house there? Don't you realize that we packed up and left there for good? That is what happened in baptism. When we went under the water, we left the old country of sin behind. When we came up out of the water, we entered into the new country of grace. I love the language. A new country of grace. It's a new life that we now live in, a new land. That's what baptism into the life of Jesus means. He's saying that when we enter the water today, when these 21 people enter the water, they are saying, I am dead to my sin. Just as Jesus died on the cross, when they are lowered into the water, they are saying, we are buried with Jesus, just as he was buried in that borrowed tomb. And when we come up out of that water, we are saying, we are raised to new life again, just as Jesus was resurrected and given a new body and a new life. It's this a beautiful, amazing thing that should carry such deep significance to us that we honor it the way that we do in church, because baptism is both powerful and beautiful because it addresses, I love this, our past, our present, and our future. It addresses all of our life. Number one, it addresses our past. It means the person that we used to be has been addressed. Thank God. Thank God. It's such good news. Jesus hung and died on the cross so that the old Mark, who used to rip and run and snort and steal and lie and cheat, and the guy that would turn his back on you, you would not have liked me at all. You would have never trusted me at all before Christ. But God addressed that person so that the old Mark could never rule nor run me for the rest of my life. Whatever I was, whatever I did, whatever power controlled me and made me do the things that I used to do has been broken. And when Jesus died, that controlling force of sin in my life died with him. He took it to the cross. He crucified it. He buried it. And he rose again, a new Mark, to take my place on this earth that would now represent and honor the Lord Jesus Christ. That's what it means. And it's so powerful to think of it that way. I laughed at this. I was thinking about this message, and I remembered a story that I heard about a young associate pastor in a church in Texas, true story, who was doing his first baptism ever as a minister. And he had worked under this senior pastor that he loved and admired much for years. And he had watched his senior pastor baptize people. And his senior pastor had a little phrase that he would use to reference this symbolic moment. And so just before he would baptize people, he would just shout out, let the old man die. And he would baptize them. And the associate pastor thought it was the coolest thing he'd ever heard in his life. He said, "Bear, this is the coolest thing, and I'm going to do it too." And so it was his first time baptizing, and it was his first one was this distinguished, proper-looking woman in her 50s, very nice dress, and she came through, and he couldn't wait to do it, and he gets over her, and he just announced as boldly as he could before he really thought it through, "Today, we're going to bury this old lady." That's what he said. "We're going to bury this old lady." Bro, I died laughing. What he meant was, let the old man die. We're not going to bury this old lady, but Anyway, it's funny. It addresses our past. Whatever you were, when you accept Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior of your life, you do not have to keep on living the way that you, in fact, you should not keep on living the same way that you were living. There is to be a transformation. It addresses the past person that we are. It addresses our present. Jesus didn't stay in the grave. He was raised to life and as an entirely different being. Oh, it was Jesus, but he was different. He was new. Bible said he was raised with a glorified body. He had been recreated by God and given a supernatural body. And baptism also represents that moment of change and transformation. It's not just that the old man is dead, praise God. It is that a new man has taken his place, not a better man, not new and improved, a new man. Bible says in 2 Corinthians, anyone who belongs to Christ has become a new person, not a better person, not a little bit of upgrade. You don't, you know, it's not just you don't cuss as much as you used to, you don't just, you know, spit as much as you used to, you don't fight as much as you used to, you don't lie as much as you, no. No, bro, the old life is gone and a new life has begun. If you have really experienced Christ in your life and you didn't just pray a prayer as a little kid because somebody told you to pray it, there should be change in your life. There should be a difference in the way you talk, in the way you live, in the way that you act, in the way you make decisions. There should be a change in your life. You come up out of the water in newness of life. It addresses our past, our present, watch it, I love this, our future. One day we won't just be raised to life spiritually. Bible says, for those of us who know Christ, we will also be raised to life physically. See, the literal grave could not hold Jesus, and one day it will not be able to hold me or you either. It is a comfort to know that for the believer, death is not the end. Not only has sin lost its grip on us, but one day physical death will lose its grip on us as well. Thessalonians chapter 4. For the Lord himself one day will come from heaven with a commanding shout, the voice of the archangel, and with a trumpet call of God. First, the believers who have died will rise from their graves. You go, wow, dude, like mummy, like zombies? No, better than zombie movies. But it's pretty wild to think of. People say, man, that sounds so sensational. It is. It sounds so incredible. It is. It almost sounds too good to be true. It's not. It's what's going to happen. And we are going to be reunited with him. And it's a powerful thing. I've done so many funerals now. And, of course, my mother just passed away. And I remember standing in the graveyard just thinking again how many funerals I've done and how many times I've read this scripture. And I stood in the graveyard and told the families, this is going to be the site of an unbelievably incredible moment when Jesus returns. So there's the meaning. The meaning of baptism is that we are identifying with Christ in his death, his burial, and his resurrection, and we identify with that publicly. Let me talk a little bit about the motive for baptism, okay? Why did God really instruct us to do this? And what is it that we are really doing when we are baptizing? What are the reasons actually for it? Let me just share three with you if I can, okay? I know we're going quick today, but we're going to baptize some people, and I want to make sure we leave plenty of time to celebrate with them. The first thing is we are responding to God's word with complete obedience. And that's important. It's incredibly important. It means that, now listen, that we accept God's word as the authority of our lives and that we are doing our very best to follow his leadership and guidance in our lives. The first thing that we are doing is acknowledging that I am not my own any longer. To do as I please, to do what I want to do whenever I want to do it. He is the King of all kings, the Lord of all lords, and most importantly, he is my Lord. And I am going to receive his word as instructions for my life, and I'm going to bring my life up under the teachings of Scripture and follow the instructions, the direction of my King. You want your marriage to be stronger? Follow God's word on marriage and watch what happens. You want your emotional stability and health? To be stronger, follow God's word on how to think and feel. You want to experience more joy, more peace, more hope? Bring your life up under the instructions of God's word. God honors those who honor his word. God honors those who honor his word. Whenever we obey the Lord, we can expect the blessing of God to flow into every area of our life that we submit to the teaching of the Word of God. It's incredible. We are responding to God's Word. We're saying, okay, Lord, this is what you said that I'm to do, to go public with my faith. And then number two, it's a bold step that makes our commitment to Christ public. It's a bold step. What it says is I am not ashamed of the gospel of Jesus Christ. I am here to declare that it is the power of God unto salvation. And it has come into my life and I have received it. And I want the world to know that I love Jesus, that he has saved me, that I am not ashamed of him or the gospel. And I have made a commitment with my life to honor him with all of my life. Let me say it to you this way. Our relationship with Christ must be personal, but it was never meant to be private. Your mama can't do it for you. If your mama loved Jesus, praise be to God. But if you don't love Jesus, that doesn't by osmosis transfer to you. There has to be a moment where for yourself, you acknowledge who Jesus is, what he did on the cross. You submit to his word. You receive the forgiveness that he's so ready to give. It's meant to be personal. It's got to be personal, but it was never meant to be private. There is no such thing as undercover Christians. There's a lot of them trying to be. There's no such thing as incognito Christians, secret agent Christians, double agent Christians. Nah, bro. Light of the world, that's bright. City that's set on a hill, that cannot be hid, visible. Salt of the earth, we're supposed to infer change and bring change. He said, you don't light a candle and put it up under a bushel and hide it. No, man. When you light a candle, you bring it out so that it brings light to all the darkness in the room so that everyone can see. Our relationship with Christ is supposed to be personal, but it was never meant to be private. It is meant to be shared. Baptism is a visible symbol to the world of our love and devotion to Christ. This November, it'll be 34 years that my wife and I have been married. Praise be to God. I wear a wedding ring at all times. It's public and it's a visible symbol to the world that I am identified and belong to Tina Johns. We are exclusive in this relationship. How would it make her feel if she bought me a ring but I never wore it? I only wanted to be identified with her in private. I liked our time together in private, but when we went in public, I didn't want nobody to know we were married. First of all, I can tell you I would go, and it would not be good at all. But no self-respecting woman would receive that. No man who loves his wife would receive that. It would be a disgrace. It would be offensive. Something would not be right about it, and everyone would know it. It's not enough to just say, I got him in my heart. I just don't talk about him, and I just don't want nobody to know, man. That's a personal thing with me. Yeah, bro. That's not gonna work. That's not going to work. It's meant to be personal, but it's not meant to be private. Baptism says, I'm not ashamed of the gospel of Jesus Christ. I love Jesus. I belong to Christ. And I want the world to know that I am his and that he is mine. I love the little story I heard about a boy. A little boy who was about 8 years old. He had gotten saved. He had heard his pastor preach, and he was so convicted that day. And he got up, and he really didn't know the words correctly, but he got up after church, and he told his pastor, he said, Pastor, I got saved today, and I need to be advertised. He got it right, really. He got it right, really. That's what's going on. And finally, number three, it's a testimony that God has rewritten and is rewriting our stories. There is nothing more beautiful in this world to me. And I'm not just saying this because I'm a pastor. I mean, I'm just telling you, I would be this guy if I was a plumber. I really would be. Because I know what he's done for me. I know where I should be. I know where I was, and I know where I should be today. And I know what he has done in my life. And it is so deep and meaningful to me that I love him with all my heart, soul, mind, and strength. But there is nothing more beautiful to me than to watch God continue to rebuild and restore broken lives. Dude, I live for it. I've given my life to it. God is working in this earth, man. He is working in our community. And we not only get to see it, but Canvas, we get to play a part in it. It's amazing. So every time you give,
You are giving to life change and to stories being rewritten. Every time we serve, every time we invite, every time we pray, every time we love, every time we witness, God has allowed us to be a part of watching lives be changed for the glory of God. And to see marriages that were on the brink of disaster be restored, man. To watch lives that were on the verge of catastrophe be turned around by the power of the gospel and the Holy Spirit, bro, it fires me up. Those who are going to be baptized today are living testimonies of what God can do when He comes into a life. Here's what they are saying to the world. They are saying, we may not be perfectly what we ought to be, but because of God's grace, we sure aren't what we used to be. We are being changed by the power of Christ. There has been a change, and there is a constant work of change that God is doing in and through our lives. I will never apologize for wanting to reach more souls. I will never apologize for desiring to see our church grow larger and larger and larger and larger. Not because we wanted a big church. None of this is about making Canvas bigger. We are all about making heaven bigger. But if you do that right, this is going to be the byproduct. But it's, why do we do it? Why are we so committed? Because, bro, every number has a name. Every name has a story. And every story matters to God. And if they matter to God, man, they have to matter to us. They have to matter to us. And I am thankful for a church full of people who get the vision and who give to the vision and who serve the vision every week. And this morning we get to see a visible illustration, a visible, tangible part of the evidence and fruit of what we are giving, serving, and praying for and committing to every single week.
Thanks for joining us online today. We believe that following Jesus is the best decision you will ever make. And if you're interested in beginning that journey today, we believe that God loves you right where you are. And it has nothing to do with how good you are, but has everything to do with how good God is. And He freely gives His grace to us. All you have to do is pray a simple prayer that says, God, I believe what Jesus did on the cross was for me. I ask for the forgiveness of my sins and I receive your grace into my life today. When you pray a sincere prayer like that and you mix it with sincere faith, we're changed from the inside out as we begin our journey of following Jesus. If you'd like more information about following Jesus, we want to give you some next steps to help you with your journey. Just visit canvasfl.com/I said yes to view some resources and to let us know you made that decision today. We would love to celebrate with you. We hope you have a great rest of your day and we'll see you here next week.